Chapter 15. Childhood, Rabindranath Tagore. Luxury was a thing almost unknown in the days of my infancy. The standard of living was then as a whole much more simple than it is now. Apart from that, the children of our household were entirely free from the fuss of being too much looked after. We used to be under the rule of the servants. To save themselves from trouble, they had almost suppressed overnight of free movement. But the freedom of not being petted made up even for the harshness of this bondage, for our minds were left clear of the toils of contents, cuddling, pampering and dressing. Our food had nothing to do with delicious. A list of our articles of clothing would only invite the modern boy's scorn. On no pretext did we wear socks and shoes till we had passed our 10th year. In the cold weather, a second cotton tunic over the first one sufficed. It never entered our heads to consider ourselves ill off for that reason. It was only when old Niyamat, the tailor, would forget to put a pocket into one of our tunic that we complained. For no boy has yet been born so poor as not to have the wherewithal to stuff his pockets. We used to have a pair of slippers each, but not always where we had our feet. We had a habit of kicking the slippers on ahead and catching them up again. Our elders were in every way at a great distance from us, in their dress and food, living and doing, conversation and amusement. We caught glimpses of these, but they were beyond our reach. Elders have become cheap to modern children. They are too readily accessible, and so are all objects of desire. Nothing ever came so easily to us. Many a trivial things were for us rarity, and we lived mostly in the hope of attaining it. When we were old enough, the result was that what little we did get, we enjoyed to the utmost. From skin to core, nothing was thrown away. The modern child of a well-to-do family nibbles at only half the things he gets. The greater part of his world is wasted on him. Our days were spent in the servants' quarters, in the southeast corner of the outer apartments. One of our servants was Sham, a dark, chubby boy with curly locks. He would put me into a selected spot and, tracing a chalk line all around, warn me with solemn face and uplifted finger of the perils of going beyond that ring. Whether the threatened danger was material or spiritual, I never fully understood. But a great fear used to possess me. I had read in the Ramayana of the tribulation of Sita for having left the ring drawn by Lakshman. So I was afraid of it. Just below the window of this room was a tank with a flight of steps leading down into the water. On its waste bank along the garden well was an immense banyan tree, ringed around as I was near this window. I would spend the whole day peering through the drawn Venetian shutters, gazing and gazing on this scene as on a picture book. From early morning, our neighbors would drop in one by one to have their bath. I knew the time for each one to arrive. One would stop his ears with his fingers as he took his regular number of dips, after which he would depart. another would not venture on a complete impression, but be content with only squeezing his wet towel repeatedly over his head. A third would carefully drive to surface impurities away from him with a rapid play of his arms, and then, on a sudden impulse, take his plunk. There was one who jumped in from the top steps without any preliminaries at all. Another would walk slowly in, step by step, muttering his morning prayers all the while. One was always in a hurry, hasting home as soon as he was through with his dip. Another was in no sort of hurry at all, taking his bath leisurely, followed by a good rub down and a change from wet bathing clothes into clean ones, including a careful adjustment of the folds of his waist clothes, ending with a turn or two in the outer garden and the gathering of flowers, with which he would finally saunter slowly homewards, radiating the cool comfort of his refreshed body as he went. This would go on till it was past noon. Then the bathing place would be deserted and become silent. Only the ducks remained padding about after water snails, or by preening their feathers the livelong day.